going on, you crazy bastards? You're back here with Rob Kimball on the Sons of Wrestling for a TNA Impact review. Now, we start off the show with the Beautiful People versus Taryn Terrell and Gal Kim. Now, it was nice to see Taryn Terrell back in the ring, and it didn't look like she lost a whole hell of a lot during her pregnancy. She nails a double crossbody off the top turnbuckle, knocking both women down, sets up Gal Kim hitting the eat the foot. It's not eat the feet to nay, because it's only one foot. So she hits to eat the foot to Angelina Love, and Velvet was still down from the double crossbody from Taryn Terrell. So, 1-2-3, Gal Kim picks up the victory. Awesome shit, knockouts division, elevating a little bit here with the addition of Taryn Terrell. Awesome. Then backstage you have MVP saying to Bobby Lashley that he's the devourer of souls, the destroyer of worlds. I think he stole it from Bray Wyatt. Good though. I liked it. MVP and Kenny King come out. They're there to celebrate Bobby Lashley's TNA championship victory over EY. And then MVP says that tonight he's going to have EY begging for his release. Well, EY's music hits and EY says, you know what? No, I'm going to ask for an extension. And then he takes off his arm sling that he had on and charges the ring. This leads into a beatdown to EY. And Eric Young is down, but we get a save from Bobby Roode again. Bobby Roode is on suspension right now, but you have the threats from MVP of what he's going to do, this and that. But the representative of the board of directors comes out, Earl Sullivan something, whatever. Anyway, he states to MVP, you know what? You're done. You're no longer the director of wrestling operations. And later on this evening, everyone will find out who, but he cannot say who it is because the person needs to be kept under wraps for right now. So this leads into a Bobby Roode looking back and forth. So that means this man can't suspend me. And this man can't fire me. And Earl Sullivan, whatever, says, yeah. Boom! Blast! MVP down, bounces out of the ring, and you have EY chugging a bottle of champagne during this whole thing, too. It was great. And I can relate to that, buddy. then we're backstage with the menagerie, and they're worried about money because his dad's going to shut down the whole thing, and stupid storyline. I don't care what you're trying to find out of this. The storyline is fucking dumb. So, so he puts Crazy Steve in and he goes, you have to challenge Sonata. Because if you're a champion, you get more money. We can send that back home and save the carnival. It looks like the carnival's in TNA, not back home. So anyway, because they're all there. So who the fuck's working the carnival back home? No one. Dumb fucking storyline. Holy shit. Kill it. Done. Bye. It's stupid. And DJ Z comes in and he says, maybe I should challenge Sonata because I speak fucking strongman style. And then Manic, he comes in and, you know, so all these guys are going to try to get a next division title match. Then we have Dixie and Spud. They think that Dixie's going to become the director of wrestling operations, and she's going to have all the power back. Then we have Sonata come out. We have all three guys to see who Sonata chooses to have in the title match. He says, you want title match? You want title match? You want title match? Oh, guess what? I just give you all a title match. So we have a great match here. Really good stuff. And Steve's getting chance again. The guy really hasn't done a whole hell of a lot to get fucking chance from the crowd, but that's what we get. And like I said, really good match. Manic was doing some really good shit as usual. How about TNA uses Manic more often? I mean, shit. He won the X Division Championship, lost it, and then he disappeared, and you see him maybe three times a fucking year. Put him on TV. He's good, talented guy, awesome shit. And, well, in the end here, you end up having Sonata hitting the double underhook suplex to DJ Z to retain his belt. And I like this whole entire match. It was good stuff. It could have been longer, but it all worked out. Really good shit. Then Dixie comes to the ring in anticipation of getting her power back. And, Earl Sullivan Armstrong, that is, came out and says, this is really awkward. Dixie, you're not going to be the director of wrestling operations. And they have champagne, her and Spud, and, well, she throws it right in his face. Now, this guy must be a pretty big guy on the ladder. I know Dixie, you know, basically owner, but it's a weird thing. Can he suspend her? I don't know. That was a pretty big blow there, and it looked like old Spud was going to try to fight him. So, anyway, that was that. She doesn't get it, and then Bully's music hits. He comes out, and we get Table's chance, Table's chance. And she starts begging him for mercy, and she starts tossing out dollar amounts. So what she'll pay him? To pay him off, do not throw me through a table. And she gets up to $200,000. He says, you'll give me $200,000? Or should I throw her through a table? $200,000? Or should I throw her through a table? I think I'm going to listen to them and throw you through a table. So, anyway, this fucking goes decent. AC3 comes out for the save. Boom, he's out of the ring. Spud comes, boot to Spud. He's down. And Dixie gets slung up onto Bully's shoulders. He's got her. He's ready to throw her through the table. But little sneaky-ass Spud comes back into the ring, flips the table over. Fucked that up a little bit, but because it didn't go completely over, it only went onto his side. So, Bully Ray was this close to slamming old Dixie Carter through the goddamn table. Man, like he said, man, she's has pretty much the most heat out of anybody right now because people want to see her go through a table and nobody can stand her. So it's a good thing. So and then later on he says, I promise one day you're gonna go through a table very fucking soon. So that's Bully's, his motivation is getting her through a table, and I think it's going to happen, guys. Everybody says no, but shit, he threw, what's-her-face through it. Hey, how many women through a table? So Dixie Carter, I'm sure, is trying to practice this. It's going to happen. Fuck it. Get her through a table. Then we have James Storm versus Mr. Anderson, and, well, this was a quick match for a previous pay-per-view match, and... Well, Anderson, he hits the Rolling Senton, and man, it looked like he gave himself a stinger to the neck. It didn't look that good. I don't know, or he sold it really goddamn well. Yeah, I like that. So, well, he does that. Then he goes for the mic check, misses it, and last call, super kick, boom, blast right to the fucking chin, down and out, 1, 2, 3. Like I said, quick match. Then we have AC3 backstage, and he gets attacked by Tommy Dreamer. And this is going back and forth. Tommy Dreamer's got the upper hand the entire time till they're going out toward the ring, and EC3 gets a little offense in here. And it's just back and forth battle here. Pretty cool shit. He definitely got some House of Hardcore plugs with a jacket, and then that got ripped off, but he had a shirt underneath too. Tommy Dreamer's good for shit. You know, I like Tommy Dreamer. Put him out there, and people are happy. Then you have Abyss and Magnus backstage, and they're embracing the Monster's Ball. And Willow, and I do like some of his shit. A lot of people bitch about it, and whatever. We're going to have Jeff Hardy here coming up soon, from what I hear. And then we have Bram Magnus versus Willow Abyss in the Monster's Ball tag match. And this is just crazy. Well, yeah, it wasn't even a tag. It was just a Monster's Ball crazy. Holy horse shit. Well, Bram ends up getting split open. We got a crimson mask, and Janice comes out. Janice gets stuck into the turnbuckle, the usual. And we got a couple cool spots, you know, with everyone in this. And Bram ends up handcuffing Abyss to the outside guardrail, so the beatdown continues on to Willow. But Abyss breaks these motherfuckers, comes back in, and, you know, he's ready for the save here. And, well, Willow goes up to the top turnbuckle after the save, gets a chair shot to the head, falls down through that board with a barbed wire. Holy shit, this is pretty goddamn cool match here. And, well, Magnus grabs Janice and tries to use it on Abyss, but it turns into a choke slam onto a bunch of tacks. But Bram grabs Janice and hits it onto Abyss, and he get the shake and then fucking pin. 1, 2, 3, done. Bram and Magnus pull out the victory. I do like Bram as a fucking wrestler. This guy, a new addition, and everybody says that how TNA's roster is so small, but they forget anytime that they do add people. Bram, Sonata, all these guys, man, It's Crazy Steve. I don't know really what else he has to offer, but hey, it's somebody new. It's somebody that is resonating with the crowd. And then, well, director of wrestling operations is named Kurt fucking Angle. Yes, it's real. It's damn real. So this is a goddamn good choice for the director of wrestling operations. I thought MVP was good in the very beginning, but then that led into the whole motivation of, you know, being greedy and shit. So anyway, Bobby Lashley's music hits and Money, Power, Respect come out. MVP says Angle's a snitch, and he brings up the alcoholism. He's like, hey, have you really got a hold of your demons, this and that? And he says well, they are his biggest problem now. But Angle freaks out, old school style Angle. Though I like it when he used to be back and forth with Stone Cold, when he'd be freaking out. And he threatens to fire all of them. They lay a finger on him, so that's the deal. And then he tells Bobby Lashley, he goes, you're champion? Well, next week you had a match with EY, and that's rightfully so. And, they get a little pissed off. And he also reinstates Bobby Roode. This really pisses MVP off. And Bobby Roode and EY, they both come out, charge the ring, and we have a fisticuffs ending. Great impact, guys. Good shit. James Storm and Mr. Anderson could have gone about 5 minutes longer and maybe taken away another backstage Dixie and wrapped up a few of hers into one. But decent-ass impact. I know it was pre-taped and all, but I liked it. What did you guys think of Impact this week? Where do you think you're going? EY and Bobby Lashley's match next week. I don't give spoilers. I try not to read spoilers. Sometimes this shit shows up on my timeline. I'm like, ah, damn you bastards. So anyway, try to stay spoiler free. Watch the show as it fucking comes out weekly, and you're going to enjoy the show a lot more, especially from reading somebody else's perspective on what the show was. Don't do it, guys. It's a waste of time. And I did see, this is from TNA, not a spoiler, Jeff Hardy and Matt Hardy will be taking on the Wolves. Hardys versus the Wolves. What do you guys think of that? Yeah. You can't go wrong there. Fuck, and we got the six sides back. How the Hardys and the Wolves in a six-sided ring, there's more room. There's just more shit to do. It's going to be awesome. What do you guys think of that? And what do you think of Terrence Rell being back and the strong showing that they had against the Beautiful People? So there's where do we think we're going to go with the Menagerie? Personally, you throw it in the goddamn dumpster. That's my own thoughts. If you guys like them, I'm sorry. So, and Kurt Angle. What do you guys think? Bobby Roode, what do you think? Let me know, guys. Personally, Bobby Roode back, awesome. And should be jumped into that title picture very, very soon. And good show, like I had to say. Anyway, I will catch you guys next time. Peace.